please kindly move forward as much as possible so we have those, if we have room for those who come a little bit later.
أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الحمد لله والحمد حقه كما يستحقه حمدا كثيرا وأعوذ به من شر نفسي إن النفس لأمارة بالسوء إلا ما رحم ربي والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين خاتم النبيين سيدنا وحبيب قلوبنا وشفيع ذنوبنا أبي القاسم محمد
اللهم صل على
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المطهرين المكرمين واللعنة الدائمة على أعدائهم أجمعين من أول يوم ظلمهم إلى قيام يوم الدين السلام عليك سيدي ومولاي يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك عليك مني سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
أما بعد فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في محكم كتابه الكريم وهو أحسن القائلين وأصدق الصادقين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم من عمل صالحا من ذكر وأنثى وهو مؤمن فلنحيينه حياة طيبة آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم for the purification of the souls and the enlightenment of the hearts and for the hastening of the reappearance of the awaited Savior, ajallahu ta'ala farajahu sharif, enlighten your souls, and the atmosphere with the recitation of salawat upon Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Respected elders, brothers and sisters, salamun alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. She was one of the most outstanding wives of the Holy Prophet, a lady who is known for her wisdom, for her courage, for her devotion and sacrifice, an individual who has left a legacy of commitment and obedience, love and service towards the Ahl al-Bayt. Lady Hint bint Umayya al-Makhzumi, known as Umm Salama, Radwanullahi ta'ala alayha, stands as one of the greatest wives of the Holy Prophet of Islam, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Indeed, any individual who looks and examines the biography and the life of this great lady admires what she stood for and indeed what she achieved during her life. When you look at Islamic history, there's no doubt that there will be ladies and females who will stand out as people who are true exemplary individuals to both men and women. Because Islam comes forward and states that regardless of your gender, what constitutes the great legacy that the human being will leave, what constitutes the station in the status in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is not whether you are black or white, is not whether they are male or female, is not whether they are Asian or, for instance, Chinese. It's about your iman and service to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is what constitutes what the success of the human being in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why the Almighty Jalla wa Ala in chapter 66, Surah Al-Tahrim, informs us that there are ladies in history that stand as an example for both men and women. وَضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا هُمْ إِمْرَأَةَ فِرْعَوْنَ. Allah says an example for the believing men and women is the wife of Fir'aun, Asiya. إِذْ قَالَتْ رَبِّ ابْنِ لِي عِنْدَكَ بَيْتًا فِي الْجَنَّةِ. Oh Allah, build me alongside or in proximity to you in Jannah a house. Which means what? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the life of these glorious individuals should stand to be what? A role model for both men and women alike. It's not only for a particular denomination or a gender. No doubt there are ladies in the history of Islam, females that you and I have heard about much. People like, of course, Sayyida Maryam, the mother of Isa alayhi salam. People like, of course, Sayyida Khadijatul Kubra. People like Sayyidatul Nisa, Fatimatul Zahra, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. Deservedly, these ladies, indeed, many of us have heard about and understood their lives. Yet there are others like Salama that also deserve some understanding, deserve us to look at their lives and shed light upon certain aspects that they indeed lived through and the lessons that we can learn from their teachings. Because undoubtedly, Salama today, for an objective researcher, a researcher who puts away any type of influence associated with what their background or what they've been told, puts it aside and studies the lives of the wives of the Prophet objectively, comes to the conclusion that after Khadijatul Kubra, there is no doubt that the greatest wife of the Prophet after Khadija was Salama. Why? People may ask the question, why? Because many people within the Islamic Ummah would disagree with this. They would say, hold on a minute, there are others who are deemed to be greater. Yes? They would give examples of names whom they consider to be better wives of the Holy Prophet than Salama. How do we argue this at the outset? Of course, when it comes to this great lady, one thing that could be said about her is the fact that when it comes to the Holy Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not rebuke her. In fact, Allah praises the likes of Salama, who were obedient to the Holy Prophet, yet also condemns and rebukes certain wives who disobeyed Rasulullah. You only need to go to chapter 66, Surah Al-Tahrim, and you refer back to Bukhari and Muslim. Yes, these are books that Muslims out there, they respect. You come to the idea that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informs us about the story of Maghafir, the story in which the Prophet of Islam went to visit one of his wives. The narrations tell us it was either Zainab bint Jahsh or Maria al-Qibtiyya, respective. One of his wives gives him honey that she had prepared. The Prophet of Islam consumes this honey. He returns. He returns to see another of his wives. Of course, who refers to the name? Not necessarily only the Shia references in history, but also books like Bukhari and Muslim. They say it was whom the wife of the Prophet, Aisha, as well as Hafsa, who had both conspired and said, we will say that the Prophet smells something which is unpleasant. In other words, the Prophet will say to him, you have come back and there is an unpleasant smell coming out from you. They both agreed that they will say to this to Rasulullah, when Rasulullah had come back from visiting this other wife who had given him this honey. The Prophet of Islam had decided then not to consume this particular honey anymore. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to him and said to him that there is a conspiracy against you, that these two wives of yours have come together and what? Have committed a sin. The Quran tells us they've committed a sin. You say to me, how? Where is the proof? Quran tells us in chapter 66, the Almighty says in Surah Al-Tahrim, warning these two individuals, saying to them, فَإِن تَتُوبَ, if you seek tawbah, you must do so because your hearts have swayed. Your hearts have made you commit that which is what? Unacceptable. That which is wrong. Yes? The idea therefore emerges, and that is some wives of the Prophet have been criticized and rebuked in the Holy Quran. Yet you look at Umm Salama and you find in narrations, for instance, in the book Musnad Ahmad ibn Hanbal, as well as Tirmidhi and others, they come forward and say that verses of the Holy Quran were revealed in the house of Umm Salama, including the part of chapter 33, verse 33, known as Ayatul Tathir, in which it was revealed in that chamber, in the house of Umm Salama, and she would say to Rasulullah, am I one of the Ahl al-Bayt? The Prophet would say to her, Anti ala khair, Anti ala khair. You are one of the righteous ones. Indeed, when you put this next to the narrations that talk about some other wives of the Holy Prophet, one clear reality indeed emerges. Therefore, when we look at the life of Umm Salama, we wish to dissect and examine her biography in a number of ways, seeking to look at her tribe, her background, her early childhood, her marriage later with the Holy Prophet, asking why the Holy Prophet of Islam married several women. At the same time, looking at her devotion and her commitment and relationship with the Ahl al-Bayt, but importantly, how she stood against the fitna that emerged at the time of what? After the unanimous gathering and the acceptance of the Khilafah of the Amir al-Mu'mineen, and finally her relationship as far as the 10th of Muharram and Ashura is concerned. When you look at this particular lady, she comes from the tribe of Bani Makhzum. Bani Makhzum were an aristocratic, wealthy, dominant clan within Quraysh. We have individuals like Abu Jahl, people like Khalid ibn Walid and others who were what? Part of Bani Makhzum. Bani Makhzum originally can be traced back from the fifth great grandfather of the Holy Prophet Qusay. Qusay was one who established the dominance of Quraysh in Mecca, defeating other tribes. Also, one of the establishments of Qusay was that he built a roof for the Holy Kaaba, and therefore we find Bani Makhzum gradually asserted themselves amongst the tribes of Arabia. This holy lady, Umm Salama, was born when? Narrations tell us she was born 10 years before the Ba'tha of the Holy Prophet, on the same year of the birth of Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ali ibn Abi Talib, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
The narrations tell us that this particular lady got married at the age of what? 14. Her father was known as Umayyah, or some call him as Abu Umayyah. He was an individual who had married two wives. Some of his children later were killed in Badr and Uhud. either fighting with the Holy Prophet or against the Holy Prophet. One notable aspect about the father of Ummah Salama was that when the Holy Kaaba was one day destroyed because of a fire, as we all have heard, there was some dispute amongst the people as to who will place the Hajarul Asad, the pleasant stone. Today people refer to it as Al-Hajarul Aswad, the black stone, because we are told this particular stone was an angel of God. It paid its loyalty and it stood to what? It stood to give its allegiance in terms of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Allah alone before all the angels. And Allah rewarded it by making it into a stone, sending it onto this earth, and it what? It was placed on the corner of the Kaaba. That's why it was known as Al-Hajarul Asad, the happy stone. Later it became into Hajarul Aswad, the black stone, because of the sins of mankind. Yes? So we are told there was a dispute as to who will place it in the corner of the Holy Kaaba where it is normally placed. The father of Ummah Salama was the one who suggested that the first person who walks from the door of Shayba in Masjidul Haram should decide. And of course, as we know, the Prophet of Islam was the one who indeed walked into this particular, the first one who was walked into Masjidul Haram. And later on, the wisdom of the Holy Prophet was there for everyone to see, whereby he obtained a cloak and asked what the heads of the clans, the tribes, to each carry one side of the particular cloth, leaving the Hajar in the middle. They would carry it right next to the Holy Kaaba, where the Prophet himself would lift it and place it in its position. Yet the person who suggested this with whom was the father of Ummah Salama, which highlighted what? Ummah Salama later on was known for her wisdom and intelligence. And it is likely that this was passed down from what? Her father and her forefathers. They had this particular trait. She married whom at the age of 14? She married one of the cousins of the Holy Prophet. His name was Abdullah al-Makhzumi, who was also the cousin of Ummah Salama. Yes, he married Ummah Salama. The narrations tell us that Abdullah, the husband of Ummah Salama, was one of the first to embrace the religion of Islam. And indeed, he is referred to as one of the Sabiqoon. He is a man who is praised and beloved by the Holy Prophet, who indeed had some kind of love towards this particular individual. We are told that this man, Abdullah, and his wife, Ummah Salama, after they had embraced the religion of Islam, faced intense persecution from their tribe, Bani Makhzum, because they would not accept that some members of their tribe had just become Muslims. People like Abu Jahl would torment and torture them. They would say, Abu Jahl would say, whomsoever embraces Islam, we will destroy their reputation, take away their wealth, and what? Remove any type of connection that we have with them. Therefore, people like Ummah Salama and Abu Salama were those who suffered intensely at that time, alongside some of the companions of the Holy Prophet. It was indeed a very difficult, challenging time where you find your own family, your own tribe abandoning you. Notice that how many times you and I speak about the notion and the value of sacrifice. When it comes to the day of Eid al-Adha, people talk about the sacrifice of Ibrahim as far as Ismail is concerned. People often speak about the importance of sacrifice to achieve success. But practically, sacrifice as a value is very difficult to implement. When push comes to shove in certain situations, we have to ask ourselves, what is it that we are sacrificing for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Why we say this? Because sometimes we get the impression in society, as far as some of our youngsters are concerned, they come forward and they say, why can't we do what others do? As an example, there are many restaurants out there. Why should we be vigilant and at the same time careful where we eat and consume the meat. Why can't we just say Bismillah and eat? Allah will forgive. Why are you so strict, some people say? Why should there be this strenuous activity and struggle when it comes to what? Achieving and practicing our faith. Why, some people say, can't we just hang around and chill with the opposite gender? Yes? And then maybe when it comes to the time for marriage, we can get married. All these questions are presented by many individuals who may be influenced by what? By the secular thought that one wishes to distance people away from adherence, from struggle and sacrifice as far as religious belonging is concerned. In which way? That we are told that in order for you and I to achieve success and prosperity, you and I must struggle in life. You and I must offer many sacrifices in our lives. That's why Amir al-Mu'mineen wa Imam al-Muttaqeen Ali ibn Abi Talib salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi famously would say, حُفَّتِ الْجَنَّةُ بِالْمَكَارِهِ. Jannah and paradise, its attaining is through difficulty and hardship. No doubt that when you and I want to achieve eternal success, happiness, long lasting, which does not have an end of enjoyment and prosperity in Akhirah, we should be willing to what? Give up that which may be uncomfortable for us in our lives, yes? Which we may not necessarily understand, but recognize to be essential in order for us to attain proximity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and indeed to follow the path of the Ahlul Bayt alayhum as-salam. You find Umm Salama and Abu Salama recognize this, that in that society there was pressure to conform, there was peer pressure, there was family pressure. How many times you and I face this in our lives? Yes, we find some of our sisters find pressure to take off their hijab. Why? They say, well, you know what, no one will get married to us because some of the brothers are finding or looking for wives who are not hijabi. Therefore, we will take off the hijab, get married, and inshallah, after the honeymoon, we will wear the hijab. No problem. Yes? It's as easy as that, as if everybody has their own plan of life before them, and they can pick and choose from religion. Yes? I tell you, the husband that does not want you to wear hijab does not deserve you. Yes, does not deserve you. In other words, the individual that wishes to take you away from the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala, closer to dunya and closer to shaitan, should not be the individual that you wish to associate yourself with. Because marriage is all about building a foundation based on the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the goal of attaining paradise. So how is it that we begin the marriage? By doing that which displeases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why barakah comes from what? Barakah comes from obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Barakah and success in life comes with sacrifice and making those hard decisions in life that we know are what? Definitely part and parcel of the teachings of our beautiful faith. Umm Salama and Abu Salama would do this, yet the pressure and the torture was getting intense. Therefore, the Prophet of Islam commanded Abu Salama, Umm Salama, and some of the Muslims to leave. And he said, go to a Christian king who is a just individual who would look after you in Abyssinia. And indeed, he did. This man by the name of Najashi welcomed the Muslims. He looked after them. But historical records interestingly tell us when Abu Salama reached that particular area, he heard that the Muslims in Mecca were living in a better position than when he left. Therefore, he made the decision to go back to Mecca straight away after he had reached Abyssinia, Habasha. He went back to Mecca. And he recognized that no, the news that he had heard was fabricated, that this was part of the Quraysh propaganda machine to deceive him, to deceive some of the Muslims. when he came, Bani Makhzum said, this is the opportunity to capture him. They wanted to capture him and to torture him. He sought refuge in a man whom many sought refuge, because he was an individual who not only protected the Prophet, but protected all the Muslims. And that is the uncle of the Prophet, Abu Talib, salawatullahi alayhi. The more you delve in history, the more you stand in admiration of this man and in amazement to those who claim that he was not a Muslim. Because I came across a few days ago the curriculum that is being taught to the elementary level in Saudi Arabia today, and it includes clear stipulation and direction and emphasis upon the idea that Abu Talib died as a non-Muslim, that he was, what, God forbid, a kafir. Why the hatred? Why this determination to fight and to fabricate and to distort the image of anyone associated with the commander of the faithful? Anybody, starting from with his father. Of course, our fourth Imam, Imam Zain al-Abidin al-Sajjad, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. He was asked one day by an individual, Yabna Rasulullah, Abu Talib was a Muslim when he died or not? Imam alayhi salam, look at the response. If you forget all the arguments that are presented about the Islam of Abu Talib, remember this, very important. Imam alayhi salam said, Subhanallah, are they attacking Abu Talib or are they attacking Rasulullah? He says, which one are they attacking when they say Abu Talib died as a kafir? Someone said to him, Yabna Rasulullah, why? Why would they attack the Prophet? Imam alayhi salam would respond and say, doesn't the Quran in chapter 2, verse 221 say that as far as those who are believers, they must never be married to mushrikeen. They must never be married to non-Muslims. Tell me, Fatima bint Asad, the mother of Amir al-Mu'mineen, all Muslims agree unanimously that she was the second lady after Khadija who embraced Islam. She was still married to Abu Talib. The Imam would say, how is it that the Prophet would allow Fatima to be married to Abu Talib? And when he died, she was still married to Abu Talib, where you claim Abu Talib was a kafir. How is this possible? The Imam would say that Fatima bint Asad was what, a Hashemite. Abu Talib was a Hashemite. Their marriage was the first between two Hashemites. And therefore what emerges is what? Not only was Abu Talib a believer, but a great supporter and a backbone for the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Indeed, he looked after whom? Abu Salama and Umm Salama, who had just come back from Habasha. Yet what happened was that the Prophet of Islam now told him, you can return back to Habasha. He returned once again, the second time. Who did? Abu Salama, alongside his wife. And there he was granted, or was gifted with his first son, by the name of whom? By the name of Salama. Later on, he had another son by the name of Umru. This man, Umru, later became a governor of Amir al-Mu'mineen in Bahrain. And Amir al-Mu'mineen summoned him to fight alongside him in Safin. Therefore, he was what? Also a righteous individual. This particular individual, Abu Salama, alongside Umm Salama, waited until they heard the news that what? That the Muslims in Yathrib, later on Medina, had given their allegiance to the Holy Prophet. And when he heard this news, now he made the decision that he would go back to Mecca and join the Prophet as well as the Muslims in their migration towards where? In their migration towards Medina. When he reached Mecca and was about to leave to Medina, Bani Makhzum came to him. At that time, of course, Abu Talib had passed away. They came to him and this time separated him from his wife and even took away their son, Salama. They separated them all And he was not allowed to take his wife with him to Medina. He went all by himself. But the lady who was truly hurt was whom? Was Umm Salama, separated from her own child. Notice, at that difficult time, separated from her husband, her child taken away. Truly, people sometimes fall in the state of despondency, depression, anxiety, losing hope. But Umm Salama would not. She would persevere in Mecca until she got her son back, Salama, and made her journey towards the holy city of Medina, in which her husband was waiting for her. And indeed, when she reached Medina, they had a house in the area known as Quba. Quba is where the first mosque in the history of Islam was built. And Abu Salama had an important role in the state that the Holy Prophet had began to build in the holy city of what? Of Medina. Later on, Abu Salama took part in the Battle of Badr. More than 17 of Bani Makhzum were killed in the Battle of Badr, fighting with whom? With the Mushrikeen, including some of the brothers of Umm Salama, who remained polytheists, and they fought the Prophet and they were killed in Badr. Later on, of course, in Uhud, in the year 3 after Hijrah, what happened? As we all know, the Muslims disobeyed the Holy Prophet when he had told them to remain in a particular mount, not to come down. Yet when they saw the booties of war, when they saw that there was spoils to be taken, they came down. Only 10 remained, and the Muslims were attacked from behind, using what? A number of people such as Khalid ibn Walid, who had a battalion. He killed many of the Muslims, and the Muslims began to retract, didn't they? One of those who was injured in the Battle of Uhud was Abu Salama. Abu Salama felt the pain and was injured, yet he remained alive. And he remained alive for a few days until his state and his condition became worse. And he said to his wife that I'm perhaps going to die and you must marry after me. Then he prayed to Allah. He said, "Oh Allah, grant my wife a husband who is better than me. Someone who is better." Umm Salama would go through the pain of losing her husband. Her husband, who later on became one of the many martyrs of the Battle of Uhud. The Prophet himself would pray over the body of whom? Of Abu Salama. And interestingly, the riwayat tell us that the Prophet himself made 9 takbirat. You know, in Salatul Mayyit, we have 5 takbirat over anyone who passes away. Yet the Prophet made some exceptions. For instance, when he prayed over the body of Fatima bint Asad, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayha, the mother of Amir al-Mu'mineen, whom the Prophet used to call my mother, used to call Ummi to Fatima, he had 40 takbirat, 40. They asked him, "Ya Rasulullah, 40 times you made this takbir when you prayed over the body of Fatima. Why?" He said, "Because I saw 40 rows of malaika joining me in salah." Yes, when it comes to this particular holy lady. Likewise, it is likely that this was also similar as far as the 9 takbirat for the body of whom? Abu Salama. Later on, people like Umar and Abu Bakr, they came and proposed for Umm Salama. They wanted to marry Umm Salama after her idda, after her period of time, after their passing away or the martyrdom of her husband had lapsed. Yet she would reject until she received their proposal at the age of 27 from the greatest human being, Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No doubt that many a times we have been asked this question: why did the Prophet of Islam marry so many wives? Why did he have, for instance, 9 wives when he passed away? And some narrations say 11, 12, up to 13 when he was still alive. Why so many? Because we have people like Robert Spencer. this Islamophobe who has written a number of books against Muslims and Islam, such as the book Muhammad, the founder of the world's most intolerant religion, and others trying to distort and fabricate and damage the reputation and the image of the Holy Prophet. Therefore, he would write things which are what? Which are completely unacceptable. One of them accusing the Prophet, God forbid, of being a womanizer, saying that look at this man, he would marry so many women. And likewise, others who have what? Also jumped on this bandwagon. When we come to this element, and very briefly, an examination is needed of the wives of the Holy Prophet, including Umm Salama. Because historians have said, you look at each and every individual whom the Prophet of Islam married, and there was a reason behind the marriage. In which way? You look at, for instance, the fact that the Prophet of Islam married no other during the time of Khadijah al-Kubra, peace and blessings be upon her. Afterwards, you will find people like Zainab bint Jahsh. The Prophet, why did he marry Zainab bint Jahsh? In order for an Islamic law to be legislated that allows what? The ex-wife of the adopted son to marry whom? To marry the father. That was why the Prophet married Zainab bint Jahsh. You look at people like Umm Salama and people like Umm Habib bint Abi Sufyan. The Prophet married them because of his mercy, because they were widows. Nobody is there to look after them, and therefore the Prophet of Islam would marry them. You look at people like Juwayriya. She was from Bani al-Mustalaq. The Prophet of Islam, the Jewish tribe, he married her. Why? Because what followed was that the Muslims who had captured after the battle with Bani al-Mustalaq, some of the fighters from that particular tribe, when they saw the Prophet marrying one of that tribe, they freed over 100 of their prisoners. In other words, as an act of generosity, as an act of kindness. You look at every individual that the Prophet of Islam married, and there was what? Either a social reason, a spiritual reason, a political reason. He would marry certain individuals such as Aisha and Hafsa due to the politics at that time that existed in order to strengthen the ties with certain tribes. You and I may not understand this today. We may not appreciate that it was a very complex, difficult socio-political situation at that time, whereby many relationships were established through marriage. Yet of course you look at the life of the Holy Prophet, and historians, Muslims and non-Muslims alike, have come forward and said what? They have said that he lived his life in total what? Simplicity. He was an ascetic man who denounced this world. Tell me, if he was an individual who was a womanizer, would he not marry and make them live in palaces, make them live in a luxury and a comfort? Yet you look at the life of the Holy Prophet, many a times he would be in the state of hunger, including, for instance, at the time where the Muslims were surrounded during the Battle of Khandaq. The narrations tell us that the Prophet for 3 days would not eat anything and would take a stone and would wrap his holy abdomen with it. And then he would be visited by his beloved daughter Fatima, who would say to him, "Oh my father, Ya Rasulullah, this is some bread that I have prepared." He would look at her and say, "Your father has not eaten anything for 3 days." This is the life of the Holy Prophet, which was what? Completely simplistic. Not an individual who is looking for the luxuries and the beauties of this particular life and this world. When this relationship, this holy marriage was established between the Prophet and Umm Salama in the year 3 after Hijrah, Umm Salama had a number of concerns. She said to the Holy Prophet, she said, "Ya Rasulullah, I have 4 children and I do not know who will look after them." The Prophet of Islam would say, "Allah and His Messenger would look after them." She would say, "I have some jealousy in my heart. How would I get rid of this?" The Prophet would say, "I pray to Allah to remove this jealousy from your heart." And indeed, that element, she stood out. Because if you analyze the relationship between the wives of the Holy Prophet, there was much jealousy out there. Sometimes they would want to bring the other down. Sometimes they would want to be seen in better light before the Holy Prophet of Islam. Yet Umm Salama stood out as a lady of wisdom, foresight, and intelligence. She would accompany the Holy Prophet in many of his expeditions and battles, such as, for instance, in Khandaq. She was one of those who would throw stones at the non-believers who had what charged towards the city of Medina, such as we are told in the Battle of Hunain. An important element happened in Hunain. What happened after the victory in the Battle of Hunain? We are told the wives of the Holy Prophet came. One of them came to the Prophet and said, "Ya Rasulullah, you know you have distributed booties and the spoils of war to people. Give us more. You know, we are your wives. Surely we deserve more than others." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed a number of verses in chapter 33, Surah Al-Ahzab. He says in the Holy Quran, "O Prophet, قُلْ لِأَزْوَاجِكَ إِن كُنْتَنَّ تُرِدْنَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا وَزِينَتَهَا." If you are looking for this world and the ornaments and the decorations of this world, therefore come, I will divorce you and I will abandon you, and you can look for this. You can go and search for this. But if you have taken this position of responsibility to be the wives of the Holy Prophet, then there are what? Sacrifices that you have to make. That you have to stand what? In honor of what this particular position entails. That's why the first lady who stood up to give her support and allegiance to the Prophet after this ayah was revealed was Umma Salama, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayha. She would say, "Ya Rasulullah, what? I am there, I will support you, I will never abandon you, I will not ask for anything that I am not supposed to ask." Truly demonstrating what? Her position and her wisdom. Yet of course an important element in the life of Umm Salama that deserves attention is her relationship with the Ahlul Bayt. She recognized what is the path of salvation. What should an individual do to attain success? Why? Because she would read in the Holy Quran in chapter 11, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu alaykum Ahlul Bayt." That the mercy of Allah and the blessings of the Almighty encapsulate the Ahlul Bayt. She recognized that in order to be the recipient of the mercy of God, she has to be with the Ahlul Bayt alayhum as-salam. And therefore you find that she would say, "I was honored to look after Fatima al-Zahra, yet at all occasions she was my teacher and my leader." She would say, "Indeed, I would look after her, but I continuously obtained knowledge from her." Yes, Umm Salama would say that Fatima al-Zahra was a source of knowledge for me. That's why this lady of light, yes, when she was about to leave this world, in her will, she said to Amir al-Mu'mineen, "Three women are allowed to attend my burial." Three, yes? One of them is Fidda, the other is Umm Salama. In other words, she recognized the position of whom? Of Umm Salama, who continued to fight for the right of Sayyida Zahra. What? In terms of the land of Fadak. Narrations tell us that Umm Salama would speak the truth. She would denounce the usurping of the land. She would say that this was given to the Holy Lady by Rasulullah. Then she was punished by the first Khalifa Abu Bakr. He said that for the next year she will not be paid anything from Baytul Mal. This was decreed that Umm Salama, the wife of the Holy Prophet, in which narrations tell us that the majority of the verses of the Quran that were revealed amongst the houses of the Holy Prophet and the wives were revealed in the house of Umm Salama. Yes, when revealed in that particular area, yet she was punished in this way. Likewise, she would be an individual, a lady, who would stand to support the commander of the faithful, Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. One day, a man who was a servant of Abu Dharr al-Ghifari, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi, who had come to Umm Salama at the time of the Battle of Safin, he would say to Umm Salama, "I'm confused here." Or at the time of the Battle of Jamal, would say, "I'm confused. She would say, why are you confused? He would say that there is the path of Ali ibn Abi Talib on one side. Then there is Talha and Zubair and Aisha on the other side. Who should I join? She would say to him, don't be confused, because the Prophet of Islam, I heard him say, Aliyun ma'al haqq wal haqq ma'a Ali, wa innahuma lan yaftariqa hatta yarida Ali al hawd. The truth is with Ali and Ali is with the truth. They are inseparable until they meet me on the day of judgment. She would say, why are you hesitant? The truth is with Ali ibn Abi Talib. That's why she stood to defend Amir al-Mu'mineen in arguably one of the most difficult situations that she faced. And that was when? That was after Amir al-Mu'mineen had assumed and had been what? Asked by the people to take the position of Khilafah. We find that another wife of the Holy Prophet, Aisha, she came to Umm Salama. This is narrated where? In the commentary of Nahjul Balagha by Ibn Abi al-Hadid al-Mu'tazili, the non-Shia. He comes forward, the Mu'tazilite, and says that Aisha came to Umm Salama and said, Umm Salama, you are the oldest, the wisest wives of the Holy Prophet, and you are the one who was what? Your house was the recipient of the most verses of the Holy Quran. I have come to you so that you support me, so that we stand against Ali ibn Abi Talib and call for the what? Call for the blood of Uthman to be avenged. Here Umm Salama demonstrates her magnificent qualities. Yes, she would challenge Aisha and would say to her a number of things. The first thing she would say to her, listen to the answers of Umm Salama. She would say to Aisha, she would say, oh Aisha, wasn't it a few days ago when Uthman was alive, you would go around and you would speak against Uthman and say Uthman was an old man who had lost his mind? Yes, you used to say to people, kill him because he has lost his mind. Now you're asking for the avenging of his blood? Then she said to Aisha, let me remind you. Shall I remind you of a time when both you and I were with the Prophet and the Prophet looked at us and said, you know, one of you will be riding a camel and will be fighting against what? Against my brother Ali. Make sure it is none of you. Do you remember this? Aisha said, yes, I remember this. At that moment, Umm Salama said, let me remind you of another story. That one day myself and yourself, together with Abu Bakr and Umar, were traveling with the Holy Prophet. And these two individuals came and asked the Prophet, said, Ya Rasulullah, who is the Khalifa after you? Rasulullah says, I know who the Khalifa after me is, but I will not tell you because I know you will abandon him just like Bani Israel abandoned Harun when he was left by Musa. Yes, at that moment, these two individuals walked away. Umm Salama says to Aisha, oh Aisha, do you remember me and you went to the Prophet and said, Ya Rasulullah, tell us, you're not going to tell them, tell us who is your Khalifa? The Prophet of Islam would say, I would tell you, he is the one who is fixing the sandal. At that moment, Umm Salama said, Aisha, do you remember? We looked around, there was no one fixing the sandal except Ali ibn Abi Talib. Yes? And at that moment, we came back to the Prophet and said, Ya Rasulullah, is it Ali? He said, by God, it is Ali. Yes? Do you remember all this or not? Aisha would say, yes. But of course, there are many situations, political, other aspects that drove this individual to lead this army against the commander of the faithful and would not listen to Umm al-Mu'mineen, Umm Salama, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayha. I saw five letters written by Umm Salama to Aisha, warning her, rebuking her, telling her, do not make this particular stance. Do not do this. Do you not remember? Have you not read the Quran where Allah says that the wives of the Holy Prophet must not come out? وَلَا تَبَرَّجْنَ تَبَرُّجَ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ You must not be out there visible, seen, lest even, let alone leading an army. And then she swore. She said, by God, if you fight Ali ibn Abi Talib, I will never speak to you in my life. Yes, she was a lady who was courageous, full of valor, full of determination, full of vision. She would never make that particular element of what? Political correctness. You know, okay, she's another wife. Let me be kind with her. Let me not say the full truth. Let me accommodate her even more. Not at all. She would say the truth at all times. That's why we find Umm Salama's legacy today is truly one that we have to admire, especially when it comes to the 10th of Muharram. Because narrations from Sunni and Shia sources describe two incidents related to Umm Salama and concerning the day of Ashura. One of them is narrated by whom in the book Al-Mustadrak ala Sahihain. Yes, it is narrated that Umm Salama says that the Prophet of Islam one night woke up twice. He woke up twice and he was visibly distressed. He was unhappy. I looked at him on the second occasion. I said to him, Ya Rasulullah, are you okay? You don't look very well. The Prophet of Islam lifted his head and he was shedding tears and he had in his hand soil. Yes, she said, I looked at this soil. I said, Ya Rasulullah, where is this soil from? He would say, oh, Umm Salama, this soil is from the land of Iraq and it is the soil in which my grandson Hussein will be slaughtered by my Ummah. Yes, that is one occasion. Yet you also look at other books like what? Like Musnad Ahmad ibn Hanbal, At-Tabarani, Al-Albani. Albani is what? Is one of the scholars revered and respected by Salafi Wahhabi Islam today. He himself has said this hadith is sahih. He has corrected this hadith in which the Prophet of Islam enters his house, the room whereby Umm Salama lives, and says, I do not wish anyone to disturb me. Yes? And at that moment, we find that the young Aba Abdullah al-Hussein enters inside the room. When he enters inside the room, Umm Salama is unaware. Later on, she hears cries from inside the room. People crying and weeping. So she comes inside the room and she finds the Holy Prophet holding Aba Abdullah on his thighs, yes? Holding Imam al-Hussein, we have not reached the musibah yet. Holding Imam al-Hussein on his thighs and crying. She says to him, Ya Rasulullah, I am sorry that I did not stop this young child. The Holy Prophet would say, don't worry. Jibreel has come to me and said to me, Ya Rasulullah, do you love this man? Do you love this boy? I said to him, yes, I love him. Jibreel would say, let me show you the place in which he will be slaughtered. And he gave me the soil from the land of Karbala. Oh, Umm Salama, take the soil. And when you see it turning into red, know that my grand Hussein has been slaughtered. Yes, these narrations are found. One other narration says that the Prophet of Islam picked up the soil and kissed it. Embraced it. All these narrations highlight what? The significance and the status enjoyed by the soil, the turba of Karbala, isn't it? That when we remember Umm Salama, when we recall her biography and her life, this was one of the elements that she wanted people to understand. That the soil of Karbala is truly sacred, is truly special. Tell me, a soil that is bought by Jibreel, that is kissed by Rasulullah, that engulfs the body of Aba Abdullah and his Ahlul Bayt and Sahaba, a soil that the Ahlul Bayt have said is one of the three features that have been given to Imam. And that is what? And that is the dua under his dome is answered. The soil, the khak, is part of the shifa. It brings healing. And that the Ahlul Bayt, the Imams, are from the progeny and from the line of Aba Abdullah al-Hussein. This element some people question. They say, you Shia, you believe this soil is a source of healing? This is exaggeration. There is no such thing. Number one, have they not heard or read these particular references, these narrations that are found in Sunni and Shia sources? And number two, tell me, if a shirt of Yusuf brings the eyes of Yaqub back within to the soil that engulfs the blood of Abba Abdullah bring healing? Isn't this fun for us to understand and appreciate? That's why our ulama would come forward and say what? They would say, do not underestimate the power and the significance of khaki shifa. They would say that there are narrations that eating soil is haram. Eating soil and mud is haram, except when it comes to the soul of Abba Abdullah, when it comes to the soul of his grave, when it comes to eating a small amount for the seeking of shifa and the healing from the ailments. And you know, there are people who throughout history have attempted to belittle this. It requires iman. It requires conviction, isn't it? There are people out there who would swear that through this particular holy soul they have attained shifa. Their conditions have indeed became better. That's why narrations, Allama Majlisi and Allama Tusi, Shaykh Tusi, both narrate this story. They say there was a man who was a Christian physician, a Christian doctor. Yes? One day he saw an individual by the name of Musa ibn Abdul Aziz. He came to him and said to him, you know, why is it that I see so many people flocking to go and visit the shrine of a particular individual at a certain time of the year? Who is this individual and why do they make the effort to visit him? The response by this man, Musa ibn Abdul Aziz, was, why? Why do you wish to know? This Christian doctor says, because let me tell you of what happened. He said, what happened? He said, because one day I was asked to go to see a servant of Harun al-Abbasi. This Harun al-Abbasi had a servant who had gone and sat next to a particular gathering of people, including a man by the name of Musa ibn Isa al-Hashimi. This individual was someone who hated the Ahlul Bayt, who hated the followers of Ahlul Bayt. So amongst this gathering, he says, I went sitting with the servant of Harun in this gathering, and all of a sudden, this man, Musa ibn Isa al-Hashimi, started to mock the Shia and said, you know, this Shia, they believe there is soil that brings shifa, that brings healing. What nonsense is this? How can anyone accept this? He said, in this gathering, a man from Bani Hashim stood up and said, by Allah, I'm a witness to the miraculous impact of this soil, that I was suffering with an ailment and I tried everything but nothing worked. Yet when I took a small part of the soil of the grave of Abba Abdullah, I was cured by this individual. At that moment, this man who was ridiculing the Shia said, have you got some of that soil remaining? Can I have it? He said, yes. He said, he took it out and he gave it to this man. This man who was ridiculing the Shia, Musa ibn Isa, what did he do? He had the audacity. He said, I will show you. He picked up this soil and, excuse the expression, he put it in his backside. Yes, to ridicule. He said, look. At that moment, the Christian doctor said, within a few minutes, he began to scream in agony and in pain, saying, An-nar, An-nar, I feel I am burning, I am burning. They came, they put water onto him, they brought him a tray, he started to vomit. The doctor said, I saw him vomit his liver, I saw him vomit much of his body out until he, at that moment, died before all of us. This individual who ridiculed the power and the impact of what? Of Turbatul Hussein. Yes? And the Christians then said to this man, he said, I wish to know who this individual is. That man said to him, this is the grandson of the Holy Prophet, Abba Abdullah, ma khaba man tamassaka bikum. Yes? Anyone who adheres to you will never be disappointed. Yes? And that Christian says, take me to Karbala. I wish to see the grave of this man. He would be taken. And then he embraced the religion of Islam and would make it a habit to visit the shrine of Abba Abdullah. We are told the Turbatul Hussein has what? These miraculous impacts, and at the same time, it's the Turba to use for sajda, isn't it? It has barakah. The narration in Wasa'il al-Shia states that our sixth Imam, Imam al-Sadiq, would have a Turba from the grave of Imam al-Hussein. He would pray on it. And Imam al-Sadiq would say, whomsoever prays on the turba of Aba Abdullah, the heavens will light up for that area on this earth. Likewise, the turba of Aba Abdullah should also be made into a tasbih. Yes, I found a beautiful narration from Imam al-Sadiq in Wasa'il al-Shia. Do you know what the narration says? Whomsoever has a tasbih made out of the soil from this khak from Karbala, even if it is in their pockets and they're not doing tasbih, the tasbih itself does tasbih for them before Allah, and they get the reward. This is where in Wasa'il al-Shia from Imam al-Sadiq. This is the extent of the soil of the turba of this khak from the grave of Aba Abdullah from the area in Karbala. Indeed, it was on the second of the month of Muharram in which Aba Abdullah reaches Karbala. Tell me, Umm Salama, this lady who was what, who had seen Aba Abdullah leave Medina, who would say to him, don't go, don't leave, I know what will happen to you if you go. Yes, she would feel pain and anguish by the realization of what will happen to the grandson of the Holy Prophet. When Imam al-Hussein reaches Karbala, he would say, what is this area called? They would say to him, Yabna Rasulullah, is known as Ghadiriya. He would say, has it got another name? They would say, Yabna Rasulullah, is known as Nainawa. He says, does it have another name? They say, yes, this is the land of Karbala. He would then say, Allahumma inna na'udhu bika min al-karbi wal-bala. Oh Allah, this is the area in which we will face the trials and the tribulations. Then he would say something that truly breaks the heart. He would say, this is the place in which we will be slaughtered. This is the place in which our children will be killed. This is the place that our women will be enslaved. Allahu Akbar, on the 10th of Muharram, Umm Salama would look at this soil, would turn into blood, would turn into red. She would stand, she would weep, she would cry. She would say that Hussein has been killed. Hussein has been slaughtered. Hussein is no longer alive. At that night, Umm Salama in her dream would see Rasulullah. When she saw Rasulullah, she saw Rasulullah in a state that she'd never seen him before. She saw Rasulullah with mud and soil on his face, mud and soil on his body. She would say, Ya Rasulullah, what is it that you're doing? Why do you have soil on your face? Why is it all over your body? Rasulullah would say, Umm Salama, I am looking at the body of my grandson Hussein in Karbala. I wish to bury the body of my grandson Hussein in Karbala. Tell me, the Ahlul Bayt reached Karbala on the 2nd of Muharram. They left Karbala on the 11th of Muharram. They came back to Karbala on the 40th, the 20th of Safar. Allahu Akbar, what was the state when they came back? Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari, he says, I was in Karbala. I was visiting the grave of Aba Abdullah. He was blind. He told his slave Atiyah, take me to the grave of Hussein, my beloved Hussein. He says, he took me, I stood next to it, I sat next to it, I fell onto it, I cried, Hussein, 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 but I could not hear anything. And I said to him, my master Hussein, how is it that I call you and you do not respond to me? Then he said, oh my master Hussein, I know it is because your head has been separated from your body. How can you answer me when your head is no longer with your body? At that moment, yes, Atiyah says, I heard something, I saw something. I said to him, my master Jabir, there are people approaching. Jabir at that moment said, Atiyah, go and see who is it. Maybe it is the army of Ubaydullah. At that moment returns. Atiyah says to Jabir, oh Jabir, قم واستقبل سبايا أهل البيت. Oh Jabir, stand to respect and receive the family, the captives of the Ahl al-Bayt. Jabir waits. Imam Zain al-Abidin dismounts from the camel, comes towards Jabir, says, Jabir on hadha, you Jabir. Jabir says to him, my master, oh grandson of the Holy Prophet, indeed it is me. I am sacrificing my life for you. Imam Zain al-Abidin says, oh Jabir, oh Jabir, هنا قتل أهل بيتنا. Oh Jabir, this is the place in which our Ahl al-Bayt were slaughtered. هنا سبيت نساؤنا. It is the place in which the women were taken captive. هنا حرقت خيامنا. It is the place in which the tents were satellite. Al-Jarakum Allah. This is the most difficult moment. This next statement is the most heartbreaking. He holds the hand of Jabir. He takes him away from the grave of Aba Abdullah. Jabir says, where are you taking me? He says, Jabir, this is the place in which Shimmer sat on the chest of Hussein.
ألا لعنة الله على القوم الظالم وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين وإنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to enlighten our hearts with the love of Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. We pray to him subhanahu wa ta'ala to hasten the reappearance of our 12th Imam and to make us of his devout and sincere followers. Ya Hussein.
Hussein,
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 please make lines here.
Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein, Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein, Hussein,
Hussein, Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein,
Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate.
Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate.
Till the skies illuminate with the light you
till the skies illuminate with the light you radiate.
Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate.
Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate. Till the skies illuminate with the light you radiate. Till the skies illuminate with the light you radiate.
Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate.
Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate.
Bear it in your heart, the son of Fatima.
Buried in your heart, the son of Fatima.
What is of Adam? What
نوح مصطفى
وارث غزة ونوح مصطفى
داد حسين بن علي المرتضى Who defied every zulm and ashkiya with his final call you still reverberate with his final call you still reverberate till the skies illuminate with the light you radiate till the skies illuminate With the light you radiate, Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate. Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate. He who taught us how to brave adversity.
He who taught us how to brave adversity.
Never compromise on your humanity.
Never compromise on your humanity.
He who fought malice with generosity.
He who fought malice with generosity.
And became the standard of integrity. Only if his model we could emulate. Only if his model we could emulate. Till the skies illuminate with the light you radiate. Till the skies illuminate. With the light you radiate,
everyone.
Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate. Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate. Karbala, your message is pristine and pure.
Karbala, your message is pristine and pure.
Never be unjust nor injustice endure.
Never be unjust nor injustice endure.
Wealth and power never should inspire awe.
Wealth and power never should inspire awe.
Everything you heard and everything you saw, till our final breaths we shall commemorate. Till our final breaths we shall commemorate.
Till the skies illuminate with the light you radiate. Till the skies illuminate with the light you radiate.
Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate. Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate. Karbala, you would be lost in history.
Karbala, you would be lost in history.
And Ali Akbar wa Abbas-e-Jari.
And Ali Akbar wa Abbas-e-Jari.
Were it not for your Sahi Binte Ali.
Were it not for your Sahi Binte Ali.
In the court of arrogance and tyranny, now forever will your sermon resonate. Now forever will your sermon resonate. Till the skies illuminate with the light you radiate. Till the skies illuminate with the light you radiate. Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate. Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate. Every Ashura we Shia must renew.
Every Ashura we Shia must renew.
Karbala's anthems in our character too.
Karbala's anthems in our character too.
Our mourning should inspire what we do.
Our mourning should inspire what we do.
Only then can we deliver what is due. Mona, help our speech and actions integrate. Mona, help our speech and actions integrate. Till the skies illuminate with the light you radiate. Till the skies illuminate with the light you radiate. Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate. Karbala, your tragedy we
Everyone.
Will narrate. Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate. Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate.
Ya Hussein!
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 Ya Hussein!